Hello and welcome. My name is Shannon Kemp and I'm the Executive Editor for DATAVERSITY. We'd like to thank you for joining today's DATAVERSITY webinar, How Semantics Solves Big Data Challenges, sponsored by MarkLogic. As you join, and to note, MarkLogic is also a platinum sponsor at our upcoming NoSQL Now and also of our Smart Data conferences happening August 18th through 20th in San Jose, California. Just a couple of points to get us started. Due to the large number of people that attend these sessions, you will be muted during the webinar. For questions, we will be collecting them via the Q&A in the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Or if you like to tweet, we encourage you to share highlights or questions via Twitter using hashtag DATAVERSITY. As always, we will send a follow-up email within 2 business days containing links to the slides, the recording of the session, and any additional information requested throughout the webinar. Now let me introduce for our speaker for today, Matt Allen. As a product marketing manager, Matt is responsible for articulating the value of MarkLogic in order to drive awareness and adoption worldwide. Prior to MarkLogic, Matt worked as a strategy and technology consultant with Booz Allen Hamilton and at Ernst & Young, and graduated from the University of Virginia. And with that, I will give the floor to Matt to start the presentation. Hello and welcome.
Hi, Shannon. Thanks so much for the great introduction. Welcome, everyone. Thanks for joining me today. I'm excited to talk to you about the topic of semantics. MarkLogic has been investing heavily in this graph database technology that we call semantics, and we've been making the investment primarily because our customers have been asking for it. There's a reason that the large tech companies like Google and LinkedIn and Facebook have all developed and implemented graph technology. And I look forward to taking a look at how the same technology that has made those companies successful in handling the challenges of big data can be deployed at yours and any other company. So this past spring, I had the unique opportunity to work on a book called Semantics for Dummies, and you can download it on our website at marklogic.com. The book provides a great general overview of semantics, and I would definitely recommend reading it. You can get a free copy on our website. The other reason I mention it is because in the process of writing the book, I got to sit down and talk to people in the field actually using semantics, and I got to see exactly how semantics is being used at large organizations to solve some of the really hard problems that we face today and to build some really cool applications. So I'm going to look forward to sharing some of those experiences and perspectives with you today, and hopefully I'll be able to cast a vision for how you might be able to use semantics in your own organization. So to start, let's ask, why do we need semantics? Why do we need a new model to model data? I want to start by just framing the problem space that I'll be discussing. Today, people talk a lot about the promises of big data. You hear that everything today is bigger and faster, and as we move farther into this digital age, big data is thought of as a solution to all of our challenges. And I would argue, on the contrary, that people often see big data as more of a hassle, that they are often more worried about it than something that they are actually excited to benefit from. I think everything is getting more complex and that many organizations are drowning in this complexity that we see today and that they are experiencing with their data and across the IT organization. And it's not surprising to me that a recent survey of CIOs at leading companies reported that data silos are the number one impediment to big data. So you're probably wondering why I'm showing this big gray screen right here. You're probably wondering what it is. You've probably heard of the story of the blind men feeling around on the elephant. And I think it's a good analogy to use in talking about semantics. The story of the blind man feeling around the elephant. You have one man that grabs the tip of the tail and says it's a brush, another grabs a leg and thinks it's a pillar, and another grabs a tusk and thinks it's a spear. And the parable implies that one's subjective experience can be true, but that such experience is inherently limited by its failure to account for the whole picture, so to speak. And it's a good analogy for the world of data in which context is so important in order to get the whole picture. So as we talk about semantics, I want everyone to keep in mind that at a high level, semantics is about gaining context for your data. So here's a more specific example of how the parable of the blind man and the elephant is playing out across the enterprise. Life used to be fairly straightforward for most IT departments. You had a few centrally managed key systems, the ERP, CRM, HR systems, for example, and data was very neat, structured, and didn't change much. However, in today's world, data is big, fast, varied, and changing. IT departments are no longer able to just manage those core systems. They have to worry about dozens of systems and petabytes of data, huge volumes of data, huge varieties of data. And the business is in need of all that data, and they're building more applications. But if the IT department doesn't deliver, they'll just go and set up their own system in order to keep up with competitors. And we start to see that problem with the issue of shadow IT popping up in organizations. You know, pretty soon the organization is dealing with dozens, if not hundreds, of different data silos. And it starts to look sort of like Baskin Robbins with its 31 flavors. There's a database for every type of data and purpose and domain. And it's not that having all this data is a bad thing, but it's that it's difficult to manage and get value from it all. It's very difficult to bring these various data types together and search across them. So going a little bit deeper, I want to show one example that has been playing out at a lot of media and publishing companies that we've been working with. Here you see a picture of a media asset, it's a picture of a dog, and you see various roles listed. And each one of these roles has their own independent way of categorizing that image, the metadata for that image. And it means that sharing the image outside of the department or organization becomes really problematic because the language doesn't align. Each person has their unique perspective about the image, and they're all valid perspectives. But then if you're trying to categorize the assets in a central repository, how do you do that while still making it possible for the particular searcher, let's say the editor, to find and use the data in a way that makes sense to an editor? So now imagine that same problem being played out among hundreds of thousands of assets and dozens of data repositories, and that's the exact problem that media and publishing companies are facing today. So here's another example that further illustrates the importance of context. In this example, I'm showing the challenges in managing the relationships between various entities. At a basic level, relationships can be understood as patterns between entities that fall into a few different categories. There are things that are equal, things that are similar, or things that are part of a bigger thing or a hierarchical part whole or part contingent relationships. In the example above, we have three things that are very different, but you would use the same search term, sub, to search for each one of these things. And here's another example. When you have a sub and a hoagie, they're obviously the same thing, but how would a computer understand that they are the same thing? As another example, we can compare the parts of a sub. So obviously a sub would have cheese on it, and then obviously cheese would be something independent. And how would a computer understand the context of cheese within the context of a sub versus just cheese standing alone as a group of these different individual foods? You know, I'm sure you're getting a little bit hungry right now. I apologize. I know it's around lunchtime, so I promise this is the last of the food examples. My point with these examples is showing that while it would be quite obvious if you were talking to your friend that this is what you're looking for, you know, for example, if you're searching for Subway, it's obvious, you know, around lunchtime that, you know, within the context of that, your friend, you know, would know that you were looking for a lunch spot. But it wouldn't be so obvious for a computer, and so they might give you results for a bunch of underground transportation options, which has been the case with even really smart cognitive systems, that they don't understand what you're asking because they don't have the context around it. There are also other examples that we run in pretty frequently with databases. They often have different spellings of the same thing. For example, the state of North Carolina may be in the database as the full name, North Carolina, but also may be listed as just N Carolina or just the abbreviation NC. And it would be difficult to reconcile all those differences across various systems that may have hundreds of thousands of customer addresses or other entities listed. So here's another problem from the perspective of a large agriculture company that we're working with. They're using morphologic semantics to create a search application for all of their research data, but the same would really apply for any large research organization. So in this example, you might consider a product R&D pipeline and imagine that you are looking at the process for discovering a new drug or a new type of plant that you want to grow. So let's say you're a new team of researchers and you're coming on the project late in development, say in phase four, At this point, the product already has a particular name given to it usually, but you want to go back and not just find information about the product in phase four and what it looked like then, but you want to find information about the product before it was given that marketing friendly name. So the question is, how do you get all of that related information when you don't know what to search for? And this is a particular problem in the agriculture company because the same name might be given to 100 different things. Or, you know, what if you're coming in as a new researcher looking at discovery? How can you search for a particular plant trait and get all of the information about it? So you can see how this problem becomes much more difficult if you're using older database technology, which can't make the connections that we seem to make very easily today. Here's another example from healthcare. There's a problem of interoperability in healthcare and dealing with different domains of knowledge. This is a little bit familiar for me since I did a lot of consulting in the healthcare industry. This graphic shows different domains that are often formed by the specialties within the medical profession. You may be familiar with ICD-9 billing codes that will often appear on your medical bills that a provider uses to tell the insurance company or payer the different things about you, the patient, and what you receive and need to be billed for in the course of care. ICD stands for the International Classification of Diseases, and it's the generally accepted standard for most healthcare-related services. However, there's also DSM, which stands for the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. So DSM provides criteria for classifying over 300 mental disorders and is often used in the practice of psychiatry. But it's a different model from ICD. So, for example, with ICD, the term psychosis is a mental disorder, but with DSM, psychosis is a psychotic illness. Describes these two things differently. So how do you account for both of those differences in a data model if you were trying to integrate the data or make easy mappings between the two without substantially changing the original sources of your data? So now try doing that at scale with these six different domains shown here or possibly more across thousands of different codes. And then what happens if a code changes and all of a sudden ICD changes its mind and starts calling psychosis something else? So this is just to illustrate the problem that Semantics is solving. And Semantics can handle these differences fairly easily, and we have customers that are doing it. We'll get into more examples later on, but I would also quickly mention the example of Broadridge. They're a large financial organization that is using MarkLogic Semantics to tie together various financial knowledge domains, including client models and application ontologies. You may have heard of one of those ontologies called FIBO. But there's also other financial domains such as FPML, FixML, ISO, and others. And you can use Semantics to start reconciling these different domains of models and having a formal approach to modeling these different domains of knowledge. There are plenty of other examples, but the point is that to model and manage data complexity, you really need a smarter database and account for the semantic differences that we're discussing. This is particularly pressing for healthcare, where companies are literally spending billions and billions of dollars on very large IT projects, but interoperability continues to be a problem we face today. So how are these problems being solved? The problems that I was just discussing aren't exactly new. We've known about them for a while. The companies that we're working with have come up with some innovative ways to help solve them. But their approaches are traditionally using traditional databases, and they really haven't worked out that well. I'm using the Dewey Decimal System here as an analogy for how traditional approaches categorize information. The Dewey Decimal System is an approach that you may have heard of. It was used in libraries for putting books on the right shelf, so to speak. It was a wonderfully elegant system for its day, but it comes with a problem, and that's the problem is that in classifying books or plants or car parts or movies or anything else, you have to make choices about where the shelf is that you put something on. It can't go on more than one shelf at a time. And the choice is dependent on the librarian making the choice. And in general, no librarian makes the same choice, just as no DBA would make the same choice about modeling data. Or no person in an organization would make the same choice as a person in another organization about how to categorize a certain entity. So a book in one library will be in one category, and another library is in another category, and a book, like a piece of data, had to be put on one shelf. It couldn't be in two places at once. So pretty soon, you start to have conflicts arise, and what was designed to be a really elegant, great solution starts to get more complex. And eventually it starts to look a little bit more like this, and it really just collapses. And it illustrates why having a simple hierarchy and a simple mechanism of tagging is not enough. The problem relates back to the underlying model that we've been using to store data. The relational databases that we've been using for the past few decades are really just not designed to handle these semantic challenges. So I want to go into a little bit more depth about what we mean by that. Relational databases are great tools, but they do come with many drawbacks. There are many of these challenges. I'm not going to go into detail about each one of them, but I do cover some of these other topics in other webinars we do at MarkLogic. But I'll summarize by saying that although the relational model is great for structured data, it is not very flexible. Relational databases require everything to be modeled up front with a very strict schema that defines the tables and columns in which your data goes in, and this involves choices and trade-offs. Relational databases are usually fixed to a specific business purpose as well, like a transactional system for a certain department, and if data needs to be moved around later to another department or to an analyst or merged with another company after that company is acquired, you end up with lots and lots of ETL, transform load. And the process of ETL can get really, really expensive. There's also a lot of abstraction involved in moving data from the relational model to an object model used by today's modern programming languages. And this involves object relational mapping, this impedance mismatch, and while we've come up with workarounds for this, and it's a solid technology today, it does add layers of complexity and inflexibility, and that really thwarts the goal of today's organizations, which is to be more agile and more flexible in their approach to modeling data and building applications. There's also challenges when you want to query across query data, which may involve a lot of complex joins or issues with indexing that you run into with relational databases whenever you're trying to do something new. And so these are all problems that MarkLogic as a NoSQL document database helps solve. And again, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about document databases. That's sort of a different topic. But you know, MarkLogic is a document-oriented database, and it can address many of these challenges with the inflexibility of a relational model. But there are also other problems that MarkLogic as a document database with semantics helps solve. So when we discuss semantics, we're looking at addressing that problem with the inability to model relationships. Semantics focuses on the relationships, which relational databases, as I've shown, are just not really designed for. Some of the previous slides have shown that handling facts and relationships with traditional databases is a huge challenge. There isn't a standard for modeling entities such as people, places, and things. I'm not going to say that relational databases are not a great technology. There's just a reason that there is definitely a reason why they are the most popular type of database today. All I'm saying is that it would be a mistake to use them to handle data and do things that they are not designed for. So as we get further into talking about the benefits of semantics, you'll start to see how some data is inherently, to use my technical term, graphy, and how semantics is a better fit for graphy-looking data. So what's our vision for the future? How does semantics fit into this vision for the future by helping solve some of the challenges with big data? Most organizations that we talk to today, they want to achieve a 360 view of their customers, or in this case, a patient, but it could be a 360 view of their partners or suppliers or any other business entity. This graphic shows healthcare, where a health insurance company or hospital wants to get patient electronic health records, the lab results, payment information, drug information, Medicare data, behavioral data, other external data sources, social media, who knows, a lot of other data sources that they probably don't even know about yet. And the same is true for all industries. People want to bring disparate data sources together, and they want to get more value from it. So that's our vision for the future. Let's jump into more talking about the underlying technology of semantics so you can understand exactly what we mean by semantics and how it contributes to achieving this vision. So my objective in this whole talk is to discuss how this rather benign thing called a triple can solve some of the challenges with big data. When we say semantics, what we mean is a new way of modeling data using the structure of a triple, which is form and takes two entities, two people, places, or things, and connect them with an action or a relationship. There's a common example we use at MarkLogic, which is a triple that says John lives in London, and another triple that says London is in England. And you can see that when the object of one triple is the subject of another triple, you can start to form this graph. And then when you connect them, the database can also make inferences. So a fact that you didn't even load initially into the database can be formed by the database automatically using forward or backward chaining. And you can create this inference that says that John lives in England. So while on terminology, you know, I mentioned that the database we used to store triples is called a triple store, not surprising. There are also other concepts that are important but probably require more time to go through than we have time today for. There's things about shared vocabularies and ontologies and all sorts of things. I don't want to go too in-depth. This is meant to be more of to show the business value of semantics. But I will show you one piece of data. It's not really code. It's just some data here. This is just to make plain what we mean when we say triples. You can see that it's just a series of three IRIs, or International Resource Identifiers. An IRI is like a URL, except that a URL is an identifier for web pages. They're really just pointers for web pages. And in this case, you're having identifiers for data or entities. And for this reason, triples are often referred to as linked data. And MarkLogic can handle any of the data formats here. There's also others. And like other data with MarkLogic, you can ingest this data as is, and it's immediately indexed using MarkLogic's triple index, which is important if you want to be able to search the data. And MarkLogic also has a triple cache to improve the performance. So after ingesting the data, it becomes immediately searchable with Sparkle, which is the standard query language for semantics. With Sparkle, you can ask the database questions like, tell me all the people that live in London, or that live in a place that's in England. You can also start to ask more complex questions like, tell me all the people that know someone who knows John. You can see that example used in a system like LinkedIn, where it's giving you possible friends that you may know because you know someone. And the other thing I'll note when I show this slide is that the example of turtle is actually shown here as three IRIs, and that's a little bit different from the examples below, which show two IRIs in a string. The only difference is that the second two examples, you wouldn't really be able to use inference because you wouldn't be able to have the object of the triple be the subject of another triple. But the spec for RDF does allow you to model it in these different, what we would call serialization formats. So, I have to ask, what's the benefit of having just a couple triples in an application? Are there anything unique that triples can be used for? And I use this example because I think it's a pretty cool example that we are using in a demo application right now. It's an example of a tweet graph that can be used to enhance a customer record. So the example is when one triple is stored in the database, when a customer 123 is tweeting tweet XYZ, and you can actually analyze this tweet for sentiment. And if the sentiment is positive, you can store another triple to show that sentiment. And then you can make an inference that says that the customer, because they tweeted a certain tweet and that tweet was positive, they're likely a high-value customer. They're saying good things about your organization. And when you tack this onto your customer record and you're able to do this all in real time, you're able to ask really relevant questions that are important for the business. You can start to ask questions like, when this customer is walking into the store and they're saying positive things about us, should we reward them? And this is just a quick example of how you're able to bring in these different types of data sources and start to do new things because you're able to leverage all these different data sources in new ways. And that's the inference right there. So you can do a lot with just triples, but I'm going to make the argument that the real magic of semantics, of having RDF and Sparkle, comes when you're using triples alongside documents. So I want to show you what looks like a document to MarkLogic. This is a document if MarkLogic sees it. This would be a JSON or an XML document. And you might compare it to the rows in a relational table. It'd be a hierarchical tree format. And the documents are schema agnostic. They're human readable. And they don't carry all of the entity integrity constraints that you had with a relational model. And you can do a lot with documents. I'm not going to go into much detail about MarkLogic and documents. But I will say that even documents can fall short when it comes to optimizing for facts and relationships, which are best stored in a graph model as triples. So here you can see a graph that's connected to the document that's storing information about this asset, about the work, about the character that appeared in the work, information about that character, and you can see how this information is inherently graphy. And with a single query, you can bring back the document parts of the graph, or both documents and the graph, and have it all materialize at runtime. So it gives you a lot of flexibility in how you want to query the data as well. So I do see a number of questions coming in. I don't have a moderator bringing the questions as I'm going through. I'm going to save some of these questions till the end. We'll definitely have some time at the end to address some of the questions. So what I'm showing here is the multi-model view of data. My argument is that it provides a lot more flexibility and agility than any other model. Here we have an example of some healthcare data. On the left is a document where we can see that an operation was performed and certain drugs were prescribed for the operation. It's very simple, intuitive, and human readable, as I mentioned. You can see that just by looking at it, you know what it is based on the context. This could be JSON or XML. It's just a more visual form represented here. You can see how the structure has meaning. It's not semantic meaning, but meaning from the structure of the document. Now on the right, we can see the relational model you might be familiar with. To get to this model, we take our nice contextual document data and then we shred it. This has some benefits as we now have modular pieces of data that can stand alone, and you can take those pieces of data and you can use them in any application shared across the enterprise. And although many people would argue that the relational model creates consistency and is dependable, I think that in reality, every data model or model things differently. And you're probably looking at this model right now and thinking, how you would model it differently. The fact is no model is ever the same as any other. It gets done differently in every organization. And the same is true with any structured approach to data modeling, which would even include other NoSQL models, such as key value or column stores as well to some extent. In contrast, the document model keeps data together and you can answer questions by bringing back a single document. You can model the data to match the business model one-to-one. You don't have to extract the business model into logical and physical models. There is no mismatch. In a document, you don't have normalization. Denormalization is okay. You can have many, many to one relationships. This is a much more simple and flexible way to store your data. So what about the other thing? What about the graph? I see the graph is a great supplement to the document model because it adds the ability to model relationships. You can see by looking at the document that there are relationships based on the structure. But you cannot query them. With semantics, you can use Sparkle to query the relationships. And this is so critical for making sense of today's data. So let me give you a quick example. Imagine that the surgeon's name on the left is Robert Allen. I'm using this example because my dad, Robert Allen, is a surgeon. But sometimes people call him Bob Allen. And if this is the case, you can create a triple to show that the relationship and then choose to synchronize those changes you make in a reference document to all the transaction documents associated with it. And this has the added benefit of maintaining the integrity and history of information. Another document database, for example, you would just create pointers to other documents, and you'd lose the ability to query the relationship. So I hope you can see what I'm getting at here, which is that the document and graph model together provide an approach to modeling data that is much more powerful and flexible than the relational model. An example that helps illustrate this point is with a customer we're working with, Broadridge, a large financial organization that I mentioned. They process millions of trades and they store the data as documents. These documents are kept really, really small and minimal, which aids in performance, but they use a few triples to insert on the document, and the triples are used to give it provenance, to connect it to the larger book of trades to connect it to the other party, counterparty, and other things that they might be interested in. So then when and if they want to, the triples can be used to provide context for a particular trade. And if the name of a counterparty or something else changes later, it's easy to update all the trades at once. You only have to update the fact in one place. So now you're probably like asking why I believe what I'm saying. And I want to provide just a little bit of a proof point for where the market is hitting. I've been talking about the advantages of data modeling with mostly structured information. And that was sort of tipping the scales a bit towards relational, because in reality, there's also a ton of unstructured information that relational databases are completely missing out on. They're just not designed to handle unstructured data, which in fact is pretty surprising, because about 80% or so of all data is unstructured. And relational databases, even though they account for about 95% of all the money we spend on databases each year, it's surprising that they can only hold about 20% of today's data. So naturally, organizations are starting to ask about that other 80%. And so regarding document databases, they are the most popular type of NoSQL databases in comparison to the other types, such as column stores or key value stores or graph stores. And these others are very important, but document stores have a broader number of use cases they can address and are better fit when talking about general purpose databases. And graph stores have also been growing in popularity, including the property graphs and triple stores, which are a little different. But I won't get into a lot of the details about the difference between those two. I just want to make the point that companies are starting to realize that a relational database is not solving all their problems. They're starting to move to other technologies. So I want to briefly mention MarkLogic. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about the capabilities of how MarkLogic manages semantics, but I want to look at the data model. And one of the biggest differentiators of MarkLogic is the fact that it does have a flexible data model. You know, it can store data in documents as JSON or XML. It can also store RDF as triples. Some people call this a multi-model database or a hybrid model, on which you can store data as these various formats. But this model is completely unique to MarkLogic, the ability to store documents and triples together in the same database and mix them together in various ways. And I think this is the reason why MarkLogic will succeed. This model is inherently more flexible, and it really makes you able to model the data and build applications a lot faster. I also want to mention that MarkLogic's enterprise features. We call MarkLogic the only enterprise NoSQL database simply because it has all the enterprise features that relational databases have and that we would expect to have for any large system. That's the high availability and disaster recovery, certified security, transactional consistency and scalability, all things that are really, really critical for any system that's trying to manage data at scale. Another big advantage is that MarkLogic has built-in search and query. This is a huge differentiating feature, and it's really what I see as a philosophical difference between MarkLogic and other systems. Our founder, Chris Lindblad, believes that companies should have the ability to not only have a place to put all their data, but they should be able to search it. And with other systems, search is completely secondary to the database. With MarkLogic, that's just not the case. It's built in, and it's a core part of what MarkLogic does. So together, all this capability makes MarkLogic a really powerful, single, comprehensive platform. And that's the reason that some people refer to MarkLogic as the Swiss Army knife for their data. So rather than spending more time talking about MarkLogic, I want to put MarkLogic in the broader context. When we talk about semantics, there's a lot of confusion in the marketplace, and I just want to try to provide a little bit of clarity. There's a bunch of different terms up here. There's probably a lot of different terms that I'm missing, and there's probably some disagreement about some of these different terms. But we're starting to see a little bit more differentiation in the marketplace. And so in the NoSQL world, it's been pretty clear there's different types of NoSQL databases. MarkLogic, you know, would be a document-oriented database. And then you also hear about graph databases. And when you say graph database, a lot of people often refer to property graphs, and they just think of property graphs as graph databases. We like to think of a triple store as another type of graph database. When people say semantics, though, they often are referring to other semantic tools and technologies. They're talking about entity extraction or natural language processing. We work with partners. We have great partners like SmartLogic that do entity extraction, where you can take a bunch of unstructured text and you can mark it up and pull out those entities and store them as triples in mock logic, and that gives the ability to be able to have a machine-readable format for unstructured data. And you know, that really falls into the realm of natural language processing. You can also use a graph of triples and a bunch of documents to create a knowledge graph. And we have companies that are also doing that on Mark Logic. And as we see, some of this gets confused, you know, with AI. And I don't want to make the point that semantics is AI. Definitely don't want to get into that. But I do think that it's a precursor for some of these other technologies, and we're starting to trend in that direction. So another thing to keep in mind is that how we see semantics today is much different than the semantic web as it was originally envisioned. The semantic web and RDF have actually been around for a really long time, and that's why we have so many experts today in the field of semantics. I put this screenshot up of Tim Berners-Lee. You probably know him as the inventor of the internet. He proposed the idea for the semantic web as Web 2.0 and really became the evangelist for it. And you can see that this screenshot, it has over 1 million views. He was proposing that linked data be the new model for the internet, and that everyone needed to start using RDF as the common framework for public data so that we can connect all data across the web. I think that that's really different from how we understand semantics today, even outside of Mark Logic. We see semantics as a great model to enhance your organization's data internally and to build smarter applications. It's really an enhancement to a powerful data model, the document model, and not necessarily a comprehensive standalone solution. And that's why we've seen so much traction with semantics lately in Mark Logic, is that it's the combination of semantics with other technologies that makes it so powerful. I know today, you know, we have big data, we have all these different data sources that are now available. We also have the general evolution and improvements of the speed of computing, but you know, I would argue that the biggest thing that is making semantics relevant right now is by having it baked into a database and having it as a supplemental approach to data modeling. And that's what reduces the ease of adoption within organizations and just gives them another tool in their toolbox to do new things that they couldn't do with their data before, and to do it faster with more flexibility. So what are the benefits of Mark Logic semantics? I'll try to summarize them quickly here. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about each one of these bullets, and I've already mentioned some of them. I think the biggest takeaway is that it's great for modeling atomic stacks and relationships. You can use semantics to create that knowledge graph, to bring in open-link data and classify large amounts of data. We mentioned the open-link data. You know, that you can go to sources like DBpedia or the CIA World Factbook or you know, tons of different other free repositories for triples, and you can bring those into your own application, and you can also create your own triples. And, you know, there's a lot of different ways that you can get triples, and using this model, you can model those complex relationships, and you can use it, you know, with a formalized common standard. And that's really, really important when you're talking about the scale that we see today with not just, you know, 1 million triples or even 10 million, but hundreds of millions of triples. And when you do this and you use inference, you can start to discover hidden facts in your data when you're using an intelligent search application that's using semantics. And you're able to visualize this information. So we have a lot of apps that might take a graph and actually visualize the relationships as well. One thing that often gets overlooked is the benefit of triples for storing metadata. Because they are this just a simple atomic format, it's great for storing facts as metadata and making that data shareable. And I've already mentioned open-link data. You know, I will mention the ability of triples to enhance the ability to integrate disparate data. So if you have one thing that's like another, you can simply describe that relationship with semantics, and you can connect things that weren't able to connect because there's simply two different things that you either had to use ETL for or just live with the differences or make one the same as the other rather than just saying they're the same based on a semantic relationship. You're also able to publish facts using an automatic process. The BBC is a big organization that's doing this. They started doing that back in 2012 with the Olympics. It's a big case study you can learn more about on our website. There's also other semantic technologies. Yeah, I mentioned Smart Logic. There are others. Smart Logic is a great partner when we want to take all that unstructured text and extract meaning from that data and be able to classify it using semantics. And we have lots of customers that are doing that. And before I switch slides, I'll mention that, you know, the big takeaway here is to remember that semantics is for facts, relationships, and metadata. I mentioned that it's important to use semantics whenever your data looks a little bit graphy. And you know, there's no best practices for saying, you know, here's exactly when you use RDF, here's exactly when you use a document model or any other model. The important thing is that you have the option to model your data using the triples and using RDF format and to query it using Sparkle when it starts to look like you're having a graph of relationships or when you have a lot of metadata that you need to classify in a standard way across your organization. So what are some of the organizations that are using semantics? Like I said, you know, it's been gaining traction recently. And today we see a lot of these major organizations that are using MarkLogic semantics to accomplish things that they couldn't do before. This list does change pretty frequently, and it's tough to even keep it updated. You'll notice two things here. There are some big-name companies that are using semantics, but there are also a lot of smaller players. It's not hard to get going with semantics. And also, the other thing to notice is that the use cases vary quite a bit. There are many, many applications for semantics. We like to say, you know, we're just giving you the easel on the canvas. We're not telling you exactly how you should use semantics. That's why I started the discussion by talking about some of the other broader problems that you can begin to imagine how you might be able to use semantics in your organization. You know, the example of intelligent search, you know, we have codified, you know, Mitchell 1 is a great example. Mitchell 1 is a company that stores information about car repair, and with car repair, you know, you have all the different parts of the car, and you want to create what they call a partonomy of all those different parts, you know, an ontology for the parts of an organization. You're trying to classify, you know, hundreds of thousands of different parts for all these various manufacturers, and even use that to power intelligent applications where you're able to say if one part failed in a car, you know, this next part might likely fail based on the relationships that they're able to define using semantics. We also have companies doing data integration at a pretty big scale. You know, we have Cabby and this other agriculture company that I can't mention at the bottom. We also have, you know, another large entertainment company that's integrating data across various silos. I mentioned, you know, media and publishing being a big use case for semantics. A large agriculture company, I think, is an interesting case study. They are building a semantics intelligence platform in order to bring over 90 different data sources together from various points in their R&D process and make all of that data searchable on one single application, on one platform that they're building. And this is enabling them to ask really tough questions so they can query the data and ask things like, you know, what is the corn yield and the underlying soil type for certain sets of data, or tell me all the genomic elements that indirectly contribute or regulate a specified developmental process in a plant or crop species that they're investigating. And the platform does use other partners to manage their customized ontology, and then they use MarkLogic to store all of the data and make it searchable. So lots of different case studies, and if you have other ideas, you know, I would love to sit down and explore different ways you can use semantics. You know, we're on the cutting edge. We're seeing these organizations that they're choosing to use semantics for things that we didn't even guess initially that they could use semantics for. I want to mention one very fun example, which is the Saturday Night Live app that NBC recently built. So you can actually open this up if you haven't downloaded it already. You can actually open up your phone and go to the store on Apple or on Android and download the app right now and play around with it. If you haven't seen it, Saturday Night Live, and aren't familiar with it, then I would definitely recommend doing it. It's a hilarious number of sketches. And what they did with the app is that they took 40 years worth of content from their show and put it all on this app and made it searchable. So let me show you what the graph within this app sort of looks like. So this app, you can see when you log in, you're asked what era you're interested in, and it's able to connect that era with different segments that are in the show that you might like, and then it's able to connect the segment to the episode and the season to when it was aired and the date, and it's also able to show the connection with the talent that acted in this segment and the character that they played. And you can see how this data starts to look very much like a graph. And we mentioned that this example with Kristen Wiig. Kristen Wiig is one of my favorite characters, but one of the things that is important is being able to search how users want to search for things. So the app even characterizes things about the characters that appear in the app. So I use this example from this segment called the Lawrence Welk Show. And the example is that in the sketch, you would never remember the name of this character. This character's name was Denise Maharel, and you would never remember that from watching the show. But you would definitely remember that in the sketch, the character had tiny hands, and you're able to actually search for that character because that information is being indexed, and it's part of the graph. So you can actually search for a character, and it'll bring up the name of the character and also the sketch that it was in. So another example is the world of Barack Obama. And this is also a very complex modeling problem. So we have Barack Obama himself. He actually had a cameo on the show and appeared as himself. We also had different impersonations of Barack Obama. Fred Armisen impersonated Barack Obama. We also had Jay Farrow, who impersonated Barack Obama. And you may have heard of The Rock, and he also appeared as a different character called Barack Obama. So the question is, how would you model this in a relational database? And I'm sure you could probably come up with some way to model it, but the fact is that this is a series of complex relationships, and it just works better as a graph. And you're able to see and understand these complex relationships from the point of somebody modeling the data and also from the perspective of a user. So this allowed the team that was building the app to focus less on a complex data model and start to focus on other things that were more interesting, like building in an intelligent aspect to the app, which they did. There is actually kind of I've called a predictive analytics engine, where a user who is watching videos gets their usage logged and then gets recommendations for other videos that they actually might like based on their usage. And which videos they liked or didn't like, and it's actually a pretty complex algorithm that works to determine the videos that they may be interested in. So the point of this is, you know, it's a very fun app. I would definitely download it. You know, it's not like a huge enterprise app, but you know, it is a revenue driving app, and it's a cool app that is using semantics. And the point is, when you put data at the center of app and start modeling data in the way that makes the most sense, and you give data the chance to take center stage, you get really great results. So the SNL 40th anniversary show brought over 20 million viewers, and that was the most viewers for any NBC primetime entertainment show in over 10 years. And I can't go into all the details about the app, but the app was as successful as the show itself. And I would definitely encourage you to check it out. So I'll leave you with the link to the book, Semantics for Dummies. It's available for free on our website. If you want more information about using semantics and want to get started, you can go download it. It gives a great overview of semantics. Also, as Shannon mentioned earlier, we have the NoSQL Now and Smart Data Conference coming up in San Jose on August 19th and 20th. There's going to be many of the experts in the semantic world gathering there together. There are great talks. I will be there. We also have our Senior Director of Product Management, Steve Buxton. He'll also be there, as well as some other folks who know just a ton about semantics, have been working in semantics for a really long time, doing some hands-on workshops as well that you can sign up for if you want to get a hands-on workshop that walks you through MarkLogic semantics. We also have other free training available on MarkLogic's website. We have engineers full-time staff that provides free training. You can go sign up for that on our website as well. And we have other webinars that we're doing this summer that are both, you know, business level and a little bit more technical and semantics. So if you do have questions, you can email me directly. This is my email, matt.allen@marklogic.com. And this is the end of the webinar. I'm going to look through the questions right now and see if I can do my best to try to answer some of these questions. So we had a ton of questions coming in. I'm sorry I wasn't able to get to some of these questions as the webinar was going on. I know it was less of a conversation and more me presenting slides, so I apologize for the format. I wasn't able to let me get to the questions. So let me scan through.
You're looking through that, and it's been a fantastic presentation. One of the most common questions, of course, is whether or not people are going to get a copy of the slides. I love all the questions coming in and keep them coming in. I will be just a reminder for everyone, I'll be sending a follow-up email by end of day Monday for this presentation within 2 business days with links to the slides, the recording, and anything else requested throughout the webinar. So hopefully that gave you a second, Matt, to look through the questions.
Yep. one question, this RDF graph database technology like the, Cray graph computer works with. I'm not familiar with the Cray system. I know that that's a supercomputer that's at a sort of different level. I think the technology we're looking at, actually just runs on commodity hardware. MarkLogic, you can download. You can run it on Amazon Web Services commodity hardware. It doesn't require special hardware or anything to get going with it. Another question is the IRI. Does that have to be a valid URL pointing to a location in the web? The URLs that I provide that as an example. Maybe that was more confusing than it ought have been. But a URL would just be a pointer that points to a document. An IRI is actually just an identifier for that particular piece of data. People used to say that every IRI is unique. That's not necessarily true, but generally within an organization you would create a URI that would be at least unique for your domain that you're working in. Another question is tying the customer to the tweet in that example I gave about the demo that's creating the tweet graph. That project is actually available on GitHub. If you email me, I can send over the link to that. One of our sales engineers created the demo for storing customer records, and I believe that the document model would be used to store the customer record, and then there would be an identifier that connects the customer to their particular tweets so that they can quickly pull up the names of the customers and the tweets or any other information about the customer, and that's a great example of how you connect it. But again, you actually look through the code. I mean, if you email me, you can actually just go on GitHub and look through how it's designed, and I can set up a meeting with the actual developer as well. As Shannon mentioned, there's some questions about the PowerPoint deck and recording, and I know we'll be sending that out so you can have the material. Someone asked, there's a lot of research on semantics, RDF, and other semantic technologies in Europe, more so than US or APAC. Any specific reason? I can't really speak to that. I think for folks who have been around the semantic world for a lot longer, they may have seen that. I know our senior director of product management is from the UK, so that probably supports that assertion. And the BBC was one of the initial folks that we started working with semantics on, and they started working on the application for the Olympics back in 2012 using semantics. But I think it's broadly applicable, and we're seeing a whole lot of U.S. companies that are also adopting semantics, and not just smaller customers, some big customers, some big applications over in the U.S. that are also using semantics. So, I think it's really available for anyone. I think it's companies that are looking for more innovative ways to model their data. And I think because semantics has been around for a while, that there are a lot of experts that grew up with it over with the BBC and in the UK. But the technology is pretty widely available today. Let's see. Another question, when you query with Sparkle, does it work only if the data documents are stored in other, stored in RDF, whatever the serialization output format? Yes, yeah, so Sparkle, you know, would only apply to RDF. In MarkLogic, you can actually use XQuery to query RDF as well. And there are a lot of variations of how you can mix the data models in MarkLogic. So you can embed triples in a document. You can also annotate documents with triples. And you can use queries to query across them. You can issue a document query using JavaScript or XQuery and then further filter that down with a Sparkle query or vice versa. We don't, again, this isn't a technical talk. We don't get into a lot of details about how you can actually mix the models and the different types of queries that you can answer. And I would definitely encourage you to sign up for one of our other technical webinars in which we go into more depth about how you mix those models and different query patterns that you can use for the different models. Let's see, what built-in MarkLogic feature or extra software products are available to recognize redundant conflicting triples or graph portions? It seems that one can inadvertently create useless or misleading triples or graph portions. Yeah, I mean, the issue of data quality, I think, is becoming more and more important, you know, creating a, you know, controlling, you know, your data set. And, you know, again, that's why we mentioned that the fact of, you know, having these unique IRIs, and I think that that's critical. I haven't run into the specific question that you're asking, so I don't want to say something that would be incorrect, but I would assume that when you're issuing a Sparkle query, you can actually just pull back data and literally visualize in our query console whether something's going to be redundant. And you know, I know in our data modeling exercises, MarkLogic provides a whole lot of tools. Some of them are custom tools that are just developed in the wild to handle data modeling and transformations within MarkLogic. So it's fairly easy to take data into MarkLogic and then transform it once it gets into MarkLogic and to handle issues such as when you do have redundant data or need to do small transformations on the data. And I believe you start to do the same things with the triples data as well if you had a problem of redundant or conflicting triples. Do you have overlap between the information captured in your document database and the info captured in triples? Not necessarily, but you could. You know, it's up to you. It gives you options, and you know, when we talk about flexibility, you can model your data as documents, you can model them as triples, you can model them as both, and then have more query options later on. It's up to you. And I think one of the big differentiating things about MarkLogic is that you can actually make changes midway through when you're developing the applications. If you were doing this in a relational database, you model the data, and then you really can't make changes later. Yet, if you did, you'd have to change the entire schema, and it actually would be have a lot of ramifications for your application code and other things, and it's really a time-consuming process. But we have a lot of customers that they'll model the data, you know, realize that something isn't necessarily as performant as they want it to be, and then they can just remodel the data really quickly. And they can do this in a very iterative, agile format, agile way, and that allows them to build the applications faster. See another question. Has your customer considered using the framework that they are developing for data supporting manufacturing operations in addition to R&D product development? Yeah, there are definitely a few examples, and you know, we're starting to hear more examples with companies that are looking at manufacturing processes. You know, I talked about the one automotive example. There are other examples. We've been talking a little bit more to a large energy company about doing some more with their operational data. We're already working with them to store and integrate a lot of their other research data for compliance purposes, but we're also looking at manufacturing. And I think the use case for that would vary, but you know, one example would be being able to store even a bunch of documentation for managing equipment and being able to say, you know, if this part of a piece of equipment failed, this other part might likely fail, and creating a graph of a equipment within a manufacturing process. And then also, because MarkLogic is able to index free text, you can actually take manufacturing document data that describes the equipment and have that be very searchable. So for a technician in the field, the application would obviously be very, very helpful for somebody who needs to quickly say, okay, I'm seeing this part fail. What is this part, and what are the other parts I need to look at that are related to that part? And that might be one example of a manufacturing process. There are probably other examples as well. So I know we're running up against the end of the hour, Shannon, so I would ask if anybody does have any additional questions, feel free to email me, and I hope you sign up for some of our other webinars, download the book, if we don't see you in San Jose in a few weeks.
Matt, thank you so much. This was a great webinar, and thanks to our attendees, as always, for being so engaged in everything we do and asking such fantastic questions. As Matt said, his email is right there. I will also include it in our follow-up email as well, which, will go out by end of day Monday with links to the slides and the recording. Matt, thanks so much for taking the time today. I really appreciate it, and I will see you in San Jose.
Great. Thanks so much, Shannon.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.